Returning to Isaiah chapter 59, please. Open your Bibles at this great 59th chapter of Isaiah. What a powerful prophecy. I can say that it's probably my favorite book in the Bible, is the book of Isaiah. Just open the Bible at Isaiah 59. Now, those that gathered here last Lord's Day will know that our subject was entitled Storm Lucifer. That is again our subject this morning, and again, God willing, next Lord's Day morning. Lucifer, of course, is one of Satan's names and titles given in the scriptures. Isaiah says, Lucifer, the son of the morning. Now, the Meteorological Office in past number of years have personalized and categorized certain storms and tempests that are about to beat on us. They called one of them Katrina, Debbie, Abigail, Barbara, and they seem to be all the female gender that they choose. I don't know whether there's anything behind that or not. But all of them have wreaked havoc. They've wreaked havoc across our island and across even parts of our own land. Buildings have collapsed, homes have flooded, factories, farms, and schools have been swamped. Trees have fallen 300 and 400 years old, and many lives were lost in them. But I want to tell you, my friends, this morning that these are nothing compared to the demonic storm and flood that has been hitting our shores in the past number of years. In an unprecedented way, wickedness has been poured out into our nation, our homes, and our families, and our schools. And so I'm taking from my text again this morning the 19th verse of this 59th chapter of Isaiah, the last part of it. When the enemy shall come in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord shall lift up a standard against him. Of course, the enemy here is the devil, no doubt. Jesus called him our enemy. Paul and Peter and John and Jude all call him our enemy. And they all publicize him as enemy number one. And the Spirit here, of course, is the Holy Spirit. So you have the two greatest forces in the universe colliding. This is a mighty text. You have the two greatest powers in the universe colliding, good and evil, heaven and hell, Christ and Satan, light and darkness on a collision course. Now, during the period of church history from Pentecost until now, God's people have alternated between these two movements, the mountains and the valleys, the peaks and the troughs. And whether it's the church globally, internationally, prophetically, or indeed individually, we all know something of the hostility and the ferocity of the enemy. And you'll not be long on the Christian road until you know that there's an enemy who attacks us. Can I say a wee word this morning in passing to those who may be in the teeth of the gale? To those who may be in some encounter or assault in your life. Maybe it's to do with your health, your marriage, your family, your relationship. Remember this, that one of the other names of Satan is he's the accuser of the brethren. And don't take it too personal. There's so many of God's people, you know, take the attacks that comes upon them personally. And that's what the devil wants to do sometimes to you. But don't take it too personally, because it's not really you that he's after, it's him. He hates Christ. He's attacking the Christ in you. And that's why those who are on praying ground and on holy ground, that's why they're attacked the most. You see, there's some of God's people, and he has no need to attack them at all. It's not because, maybe, my dear friend, this morning, the attack upon you this morning, it's not because you're bad or you blundered. He didn't pour his wrath upon Christ for that sake. He knew that Christ had no faults. He knew he had no failures. He knew that he was wholly harmless and undefiled. But because of the damage he was going to do. And he doesn't like you this morning because of the threat you are to his kingdom. So when the trouble comes and the trial comes and the subtlety of the enemy hits you, remember this. It's not because you have done something. It's because maybe you're going to do something for the Lord that he doesn't like. And his goal is to silence. His goal is to throw confusion. His goal is to strike at the heart of some father, some mother, some elder, some deacon, to stop the blessing. Paul says we're not ignorant of his devices, but I believe that some of us are ignorant of his devices. Now, last Lord's Day, I specified the flood from the scripture in three ways. First of all, I say the flood is noisy, or I'm going to add another word to that this morning, the flood shouts, because Psalm 93 says the floods have lifted up their voice. Peter says the devil goes about like a roaring lion. A flood is noisy. You'll hear the roar of it. And the flood is scary. Psalm 18 and verse 4. The floods of ungodly evil men make me afraid. And Jesus said in these last days, men's heart will fail them because of fear. Fear not this morning. And the flood is sudden, because for weeks and months that rain saturating into the mountains and into the hills and into the streams and into the trees and everywhere that it can get a place to rest. But there comes a time, you know, when those things are not able to take any more. There comes a time when it so saturates the land, the hills, the mountains and the rivers that it breaks forth and comes down upon us. And that's what's happening. For years and years, this whole enemy's work has been building up and building up in a crescendo towards the last days. The mystery of iniquity does already work. The powers of hell are building up and building up for the final onslaught. The final onslaught is upon us, my friends. This is a wake-up call. The noise, the flood. It's a wake-up call to God's people. The final deluge is on the way. It has started, and it has well and truly started. And I'll tell you, it's gathering momentum day after day. Who would have ever thought in 5 years ago we'd be at the things even that we're at today? There doesn't seem to be anything restraining at the minute. An unprecedented move of evil and iniquity and immorality and infidelity. And as far as the West is concerned, I don't see any sign of the second part of this text being operated. And the enemy's come in like a flood. I don't see any sign of the Spirit of God standing against them at the moment. And I'll show you some of the reasons. We'll have to see them from the Word of God. The enemy is in like a flood. It seems that the tide is perpetually and systemically flowing, unchallenged, unbated, unresisted. But I thank God for the second part of this text. And I tell you what I thank God for more than anything else. I thank God for the comma. When the enemy comes in like a flood, there's a comma. I tell you here about watching the wee words, watch the wee commas too. There's a comma here. There's a prophecy here. There's a promise here. And I tell you, my friend, I with all my heart believe this part of the text. When the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord shall lift up a standard against him. There's no doubt about that. It's not that he may or he might. And it's not, I'll tell you, it's not if the devil comes, it's when he comes. And he has come. But the Spirit of the Lord, the Holy Ghost, the Paraclete, the mighty Holy Spirit will stand. God himself will stand again. One day he's going to stand in our land. And we're going to see it. And he's going to drive back all the forces of hell. And I'll tell you, I trust that I'll be here to see it. When the enemy comes in like a flood. Come on, the Spirit of the Lord shall lift up a standard against him. And we'll be going into that word standard next week. It's a banner. It's an ensign. I say men and women this morning, Christians this morning, rally behind the banner. The battle's on. The battle's on. Now, when we put this text in its context, there's a number of reasons why the Spirit of God is not working. And we touched them last Sunday. And the first one is unbelief or the lack of faith. You see, he must put all scriptures in its context. What the people of God in captivity, and that's where they are at this time, what they were saying is this. Just what many are saying this morning, where is God? I hear it all the time. Where is God? Not only from Nolan, I wouldn't pass much imagination here from none, but from God's people. Where is God? What's God doing? You see, there were false prophets in these days that had told these people that God was coming and that he was going to rescue them. And they give certain even dates and times when they would do it, and then times and dates passed, and they were all disillusioned and disappointed and brokenhearted. They're in captivity. The enemy has come in like a flood and taken Jerusalem, taken their people, taken their children. And the cry is, where's God? And that's why we have verse 1 of 59th chapter. Because God vindicates himself. God comes against what they're saying in the first verse of this chapter. Get your eyes on the first verse of this chapter. Because God comes with a behold. I couldn't see it the way that it is meant to be said. Because God says to them here, do you think that my hand's short that I can't save? Do you think that my ear's too heavy that I don't hear? Is that what you're saying? My hand too short that I can't reach down to the most evil and wicked sinner? Do you believe that this morning? Do you believe that God hears the cry of the righteous this morning, or does he not? Do you think that his hand's stumped this morning, docked this morning, that he can't reach to the drunkard, to the alcoholic, to the most filthiest of men? Do you think he has changed? Do you think his hand's short? This hand of power? Do you think that he has no power today to save, to heal, to bless? That's what they're saying. That's what they're saying. And they were right. It's not that God's hand wasn't able to do it. It's not that he had changed anything in power. It's not that he was deaf. It's not that he had walked away altogether from his people. The fact is this. In verse 2, look. But your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you, that he will not hear. These people here, God had shut his ears to them, and he had stopped working for them, but he was still the same God. You see, in Isaiah 58, the one before this, the people are saying to God, listen, we have fasted, we have prayed, we have cried, we have given sacrifices, we've helped the poor. You read 58. We have done all these things and nothing's happening. So therefore we are saying that God is not able to do it. And the fault is God's. That's what they're saying. And listen, before you go on a rant this morning, wherever you are, whoever you are, before you go on a rant against God, look at yourself. Before we start blaming God for the state of our family and the state of our children and the state of our land and the state of our church, God's hand's not short and God's ear's not heavy. The God of 1859 and 1904 and the God of Kells and Wales and Azusi Street and Fulton Street and China and India and New York and Wales and the Moravians and the Aborigines and the Zulus, where he moved in mighty revivals across them all, are still the same today. Where's God? Don't be going on a rant to blame God this morning. Just sit down and examine yourself. And examine yourself and according to this word here. Don't be blaming him of weakness and of deafness and of carelessness, because he says, behold, my hand is able to reach and my ear is hearing, but there's a problem and it's not with me. God says it's not with me. That's what he's saying. Don't be blaming me for this. Oh, I'm glad the second verse and the rest of these verses in this chapter's here. Don't be blaming me for this. Peter says the time has come when judgment must begin at the house of God. Not at the throne of God. It has to begin at the house of God. C.H. Lewis said on one occasion, he says, if I could get a hold of God for the things that he has done, I'd spit in his face. Well, men did spit in his face, and it didn't make any difference. And whether we spit in his face or not, or whether we argue or not, or whether we remonstrate or not with God and blame him and accuse him for some of the things that are going on even in the world today. We need to look at ourselves and look at the Word. Behold, it's not me. It's not me, it's you that the problem's with. How can these people say, how can you say that I cannot save? How can you say that I would do this on a people? How can you people say that I don't say that I cannot save you? I cannot hear you. Who heard you when you groaned in Egypt? Who delivered you from 420 years from the bondage of Pharaoh? Who delivered you by the blood of the Lamb and brought you out that night? 2 million nearly of you, and the dog never even barked. Who heard your voice at the Red Sea when you cried, when the mountains were one side and Pharaoh was behind and the sea was in front of you and you were in the corner and you were bait and you were stuck and you cried, Moses cried, who heard you? Who heard you when you parched in the wilderness with thirst and hunger and cold? Who gave you the manna every day, the water from the rock, and the pillar of cloud by day, and fire by night to keep you warm? When you cried and when you prayed, who heard you? I heard you. And I answered you. Who heard you when the Jebusites and the Amalekites and the Philistines all come against you? Who heard you when you cried? Who heard you in the times of the judges when every man did that which was right in his own eyes, and one after another I raised 13 judges up to deliver the land? How can you level such an accusation at God? And how can you do it either this morning? When you cried for that job, who was it that heard you? Huh? When you cried for the sick child, who was it that heard you? When you cried for the dilemma in the home and in the family, who heard you? When you cried the day that car nearly pulled out in front of you, who heard you? He heard you, and he answered you. Who heard you the day you cried for salvation? Who heard me that day down on that street in Fermanagh 46 years ago? Who heard me when I said, Lord, I'm tired of this life? Who heard me? He did. And he saved me and delivered me, and the same with you. Why don't you say he doesn't hear? Don't you say he's not able. And don't you say there's any man about Dungannon that he can't save for this mission. 1987, we had a portable hall in Derrigonley, a mile from where Pat lived. 2 miles or more from where I lived. Alvin Mullen of the Baptist put it up and asked me to come down and preach and we said we'd go and visit for a week, and Pat and I went down to visit. And we went to our neighbours and right round where I'd done the milk run and the town that Pat lived in. And we're sitting in the town of Derrigonley one morning, just saying to one another, where will we go today? And then this wee man walked up past, and I says to Pat, that's Tommy McLean. Oh, she says, it is. She says, away with an invitation to him. I says, I'll not. But I knew Tommy McLean. And I says, that man will not come to the mission. And he was in the skip every day, hooking stuff out of it, and he was in the bond store bar drinking every night, and his wife's heart broke, and children. She says, give me that invitation. Now she got up the street after him. Told him who she was. He says, Patricia, I'll come. And he came on the Monday. He came, and on the Monday night of the second week, he got down on his knees. He cried to God. I tell you, that was 1987. I visited him the other day. I tell you, for 10 years he had open airs at his home every July, and I went down and preached at them on a Sunday afternoon. And because Tommy was converted and he had a great testimony, the whole neighbourhood gathered. Don't you say that man's too hard. Someone will come into your house this week. Do you let him out? Whether he's a Catholic or a Protestant, say to him, I'll call for you. Because he has no hands but our hands to do his work today. And the thing about this, my friend, is it may be that you're the only one that can reach that person. The Lord Jesus left the man at the gate of the temple for Peter and John. Well, he went up and through and passed that by many a day. He left him for Peter and John. No, don't say he's not able. We have offered sacrifices. We have fasted. We have prayed. We have given to the poor. We have done everything, and there's no sign of God. Well, I go to church and I say my prayers and I sing hymns and I meet around the table. No sign of God. Is there something wrong? Is there something wrong? No faith. Believe ye that I am able to do this, he says to the blind man, yea, Lord, we believe. Is there anything too hard for God? Listen, is there anything down too far that the Lord can't reach? Are you going to limit the Holy One of Israel now? Is there any weak cry so faint that he'll not hear? Oh, God, help our unbelief. No faith in God. Secondly, there was no fear of God. Look at verse 2 again. But. Now watch it. But you're. He's not talking about me now. He's talking about you. He's not talking about you. He's talking about me. But your iniquities have separated between you and your God. And your sins have hid his face from you that he will not hear. For your hands are defiled with blood, and your fingers with iniquity, and your lips have spoken lies, and your tongue has muttered perverseness. That's how he comes back to them again. You don't be blaming me. Don't be accusing me. Look at yourself. Boys, I'll tell you, there's some catalogue of stuff here. Take you a week. 6 parts of the body is mentioned here. Now, take heed now what I'm going to say as we come to a close. There's 6 parts of the body mentioned here. And the opening message yesterday was Romans 12 and 1. I beseech ye, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies. Watch the parts of the bodies that are mentioned here. Verse 3, the hands, your fingers, your lips, or your tongue. Look at verse 7, your feet. Look at verse 7 again, your thoughts. To shed innocent, their thoughts are thoughts of iniquity. Look at verse 13. In transgression and lying against the Lord and departing way of speaking, oppression and revolt conceived and uttering from the heart. That's just a quick scan through it. Hands, fingers, tongue, feet, thoughts, heart. Well, might we say like Isaiah, from the sole of her foot to the head, there's full of wounds and bruises and putrefying sores. Well, might we sing like that hymn that was mentioned yesterday by Francis Redding and Harville, take my life and let it be. Take my hands and take my voice and take my will and take my silver and my gold and take my love. Because here lies the problem of no blessing. Here lies the problem of no revival. Listen, friends, and I say this with all humility, I trust this morning, that we'll never drive back the flood just by meeting round the table, nor saying the wee prayers, nor coming to the meeting. That is not a threat to the devil, and you will see next week what is. Let me just take a moment here to look at three things here of the body parts that he talks about. And first of all, the hands and the fingers. Can I say a wee word nationally about the hands and the fingers? I'm not talking to the church, I'm talking about the nation. Bloody hands. For your hands are defiled with blood. From 1967, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of thousands of children have been murdered by abortion. And their hands and their fingers have worked iniquity. And there's going to be a day of judgment for it. And the nation's under wrath because of it. But we must leave that to another day. The hand speaks of many things, but the main function of the hand is to grip, to hold, to take, and to give. Is the Lord not blessing? Is the Lord not hearing? Is the Lord not saving? Is the Lord not restoring? Because we are not prepared to release something. We're not prepared to let something go. We want to hold on to it. Are we taking something that we shouldn't take? Are we not prepared to give what we should be given? We will not release something. We will not let it go, he said. God has spoken. And I'm saying to you, I believe that he has spoken to some of you people and some people listening to me this morning, time and time again, to let it go when you haven't let it go. You're still holding on to that old sin. And the Lord will not hear you. Pray away. Don't weary yourself. God says they've wearied me in sacrifices and offerings, but not here. Let it go. Time and time again, he says, give it up. Let it go. Maybe it's a lust. Maybe it's a lodge. Some old lodge you're stuck in. And you'll go to the meetings in the lodge, but you'll not go to the prayer meetings. Some old cursed thing that has dragged you down and taken the joy of the Lord out of you. The lust. Maybe it's a lodge. Maybe it's a love. Maybe it's a luxury. Maybe it's a lie. I don't know what it is. But I say this morning, let him go. Let her go. But it's going to stop the blessing. Maybe something you need to hand back, hand up, hand in, hand over. And maybe it's your fingers that's hindering you. You're touching some things that you shouldn't touch. I tell you, there's a lot of things God says in this word, don't touch. And one of them is, don't touch the Lord's anointed. And whatever you think of my preaching and whatever you think of me or anybody else that preaches the word of God, you leave them alone. The anointed of God, or they should be. You shut your mouth, touch not the Lord's anointed, and do his prophets no harm. Maybe that this morning. What are you touching this morning? What are you tinkering with this morning? And that old Facebook thing, and the old internet, twiddling with something on that mobile phone. And this is serious business. And when the wife and the children are in bed, you're tinkering with the controls. God only knows what you're watching. Chapter 58 says, the light shall break forth as the morning, and the Lord shall answer thee if thou take away the putting forth of thy finger and the speaking of vanity. And then lastly it says in verse 3, your tongue hath muttered perversiveness. Muttered or uttered. That's moanings and groanings and complainings and criticizing. And those three alone, the Lord says, I can't hear. I'll not hear. I'll not save. I'll not reach out. I'll not save your son or your daughter. I'll not save in the mission until you get these things right. Do you think that's an exaggeration of the Word of God? Not a bit of it. I can't do it. If you're going about complaining and muttering and whispering under your tongue about preachers and about brothers and sisters in the Lord, instead of getting away and repenting and saying sorry and getting it right. Oh, but I didn't do it. No, you didn't. Maybe you did. Moanings and groanings and backbitings. Those are only three. That's not going into the depth of this text at all. Why is the enemy? Why is God not lifting the standard? Why are we having so many meetings and missions and carry on around us and nothing happening? Is it his fault? No. Is it our fault? Yes. No faith, no fear. And next week we look at no fight. Look at verse 16. No fight or no fire. He says in verse 16, and he saw that there was no man and wondered that there was no intercessor. That text sat right in the heart of this. That word wonder is a very amazing word. It means to stagger with unbelief. It actually means to be numb with devastation. It means to be dazed and staggering and bewildered and numb with devastation. And this is God. We never read, and I'm trying to be corrected, but we never read of God saying this about anything else. Friends, listen. He's not staggered and numb and bewildered because of their sin. He doesn't say that. Because he knows very well the makeup of us. He knows that we backslide and we sin and we fall. He's not saying that. He comes in time and time again and rescues us from that. But there was no intercessor. There was nobody to groan and cry and weep and grab hold of God. The word actually means to jump on somebody. There was no intercessor. What he's saying is, here's the people have the weapon. Here's the people have the answer. Now, God's people are all not supposed to be intercessors. I know that. But some are. But who is the day? You have the weapon, he's saying. You have the way of stemming the flood. I can't do it until we get an intercessor. And you'll see next week, my friend, this was the way with Abraham at Sodom and the Sodomites. This is the way with Elijah on Carmel. This is the way of Paul. This is the way of many of the servants of God down through the years. When God wondered that there was no man to stand in the gap, he wondered, he couldn't find, there's no intercessors. There's plenty of preachers and there's plenty of boys saying wee prayers and there's plenty of prayer meetings, but there's no intercessors. There's nobody desperate enough, burdened enough, weeping enough, howling enough. Because that's what the word means. And God, may God raise up intercessors to stand in the gap and stem the flood before it swamps all before it. I tell you, we need them in the Baptist, we need them in the Church of Ireland, you need them in the Independent. We need them. We need intercessors. We're coming near to it in here in the morning to 6 o'clock, you know. And God will hear. And he will come in like a flood. But this was his problem. Once you get these other things right, your hands and your leg, your feet and all the rest right, he says, and there's intercessors, I'll come. Not until then. And so we'll see next week as we go on. The storm, Lucifer, needs to be stayed. Needs to be stayed. Let us pray. Father, we give you thanks this morning for your word, and we just ask, Lord, that you will take away that which has been of myself and apply that which has been of yourself. That's all I ask this morning, Father. Anything in the flesh, Lord, diminish it. Defeat it, destroy it this morning. And what's in the spirit, let it rest and abide into the hearts far beyond the reach of the enemy. That through this message, some will begin to lay hold of God for revival and blessing on our land. Amen.